Good afternoon, everybody. So this session we will have mostly on the asset management for the rooftop segment. What are the opportunities, challenges, and what are the methods which are adopted by different organization for the having the effective asset management in terms of maintenance, preventive, and the corrective actions taken. So I would like first to welcome Mr. Ramesh Kumar from Amplus for his presentation.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ramesh Kumar, AVP-O&M of Amplus Solar. Amplus, to give just an introduction to the people who are new to the solar rooftop industry, Amplus is one of the major players in the solar rooftop sector with above 100 plants already installed, operational. And we're also doing ground mount projects of around 50 to 60 megawatt of installed capacity we already have. And we are doing a project of 175 megawatt peak in the state of Karnataka under open access model, which is probably the biggest site in India under open access. Now, I'm here today to discuss about the challenges in O&M of rooftop solar. Before I start, I would like to request the audience to consider the solar rooftop industry because it is relatively younger compared to the solar ground mounts. So some of the things that may look very basic to you, but I would like to touch upon the basics of O&M only in my presentation of solar rooftops. There is an interesting question before starting this. What is the O&M cost per megawatt of a rooftop solar power plant? If someone can give me a number for it. That is an interesting question. Well, there is no specific answer, as you have, many of you know. That can vary from somewhere around 4 lakh rupee megawatt to as high as 20 lakh rupee per megawatt. It is basically because of two main reasons, which is the size and location of the plant. Depending on the size and location of the plant, how the cost can vary. Just to illustrate, I have taken two examples. To the right, I have provided 1 megawatt of capacity spread across 5 200 kilowatt peak sites. And I am assuming that each site is managed by a dedicated resource. And the cost, O&M cost, is coming to around 33% of the revenue that the project can generate. So it clearly rules out a possibility of keeping a dedicated resource at each of the solar power plants in rooftop. And to the left is a case where 3 megawatt of capacity spread across 15 sites of the same capacity again is managed by a single resource like engineer or technician. And the cost will be dropping down to 7 lakh rupee per megawatt, which is still higher considering the present day, you know, targets that are being set, because it is always compared to the ground mount solar. So we now know that it is not possible to manage the site with dedicated resources, and we have to keep multiple. We have to load as many sites possible on each of the engineers that we have. So probably around 20 to 25 sites loading on one engineer or technician is what we are looking about. So how to do it? We are doing it in two ways at Amplus. We monitor all the plants from remotely, a centralized location, which we call it as a remote operation center, ROC, which basically continuously communicates and coordinates with the site engineers. They do the analysis in case of performance lapses, and they inform this performance deviations to the site engineers to respond quickly. And second part of it is the automation. Automation in Amplus, what we have done to reduce the downtime of the plants, we have given an SMS alert based system to the site engineers. An SMS is generated in case of any breakdown of the plant, and the plant is not getting restored within a 15 to 20 minutes time, so that the engineer knows which site he has to visit today. The other part is to optimize the resources. Yes, if you want to load more sites on a single engineer, like 20 to 25 sites when we are speaking in a geography of say around 150 to 250 kilometers spread, we need to invariably enable the site engineers with the technology. We've already given the tabs to each of our O&M engineers who are visiting site. And all the preventive maintenance and breakdown maintenance, we have inbuilt checklist into the tab. And photographs also can be captured and uploaded into the ERP system of the company instantaneously. That's what we have done. And second important thing is the standardization. if we want to reduce the O&M cost and increase the number of sites on a single engineer, it is important to have standardization of systems and processes. At Amplus, we do like O&M plan for the complete year, one full year covering all the plants under operation, and we give it to the site engineers along with the resource allocation plan. This actually reduces the O&M cost to a significant extent. Of course, execution of the plan is very important. Any plan without proper execution is of no use. Third most important thing when it comes to the rooftop sector is the documentation part. In my personal opinion, we in rooftop segment were severely lacking in the documentation part. This documentation could actually help us save millions of rupees when we are talking about a 40,000 megawatt capacity of installed capacity in India. So what we do basically using the documentation is that we want to isolate the site from a particular engineer or the technician. Irrespective of who is visiting the site, even for the first time, he should be able to address the issue properly, troubleshoot the problems and bring back the site into operation. That is very important. If you follow a proper documentation procedure, then anyone can understand the history of any problem and then immediately attend the problem. That's the essence of it. And next advantage of documentation is that we are feeding it back to the engineering team and the construction team, whatever observations we have during the O&M, so that in our future projects, the same mistakes are not getting repeated. The third advantage is because of the geographical spread of the site, spare parts management is very difficult in solar rooftops. Particularly, you cannot decide on the volume of the space and the cost of the space, and particularly the location of the space where you need to keep. So in order to overcome this challenge, you need to have at least data of 1 or 2 years operation. Along with proper documentation, we are in a better shape to position to actually optimize the spare parts cost. Other challenges are mainly related to the client. When I say client related issues, one of the major issues is the load variability of the client. Particularly on public holidays, what we have seen is that because the client's load drops to a minimum or zero, we are forced to stop our plant. That is one case. The other case is whenever they are carrying out a preventive maintenance on their electrical system or their plant machinery itself, we have been ordered to curtail the solar power plant, causing us a generation loss. Third major issue is when we are doing a regular O&M activity like cleaning or the preventive maintenance. This happens with the reputed clients because they have their own internal systems and processes in place. In order to comply with their protocols, we sometimes have to waste our resources for a half a day or a full day. And it actually puts pressure on the tightly managed resource plan of the rooftop solar O&M team. In order to overcome this, what we are doing is that at the time of PPA with the clients, we have to be very clear on the scope on what we are going to do. Because some of the clients, it is very nature of the clients that, you know, anything that happens on the roof is a problem of rooftop solar company, irrespective of whether they are directly responsible for it or not. So that needs to be clearly stated in the agreements. The other part is there should be a deemed generation clause in each and every agreement. Of course, it has a limited use. I cannot go back to the client every day and ask for a deemed generation. But in extreme cases where my generation loss extends beyond a week or so, I'm actually covered by the deemed generation clause of the agreement. And vendor management, again, particularly with respect to this cleaning of the solar modules, it is difficult to find professional vendors in remote areas of the country. Even if you get a reputed vendor to work for you on a rooftop solar cleaning, he in turn gives it to a local vendor. Again, the same problem continues on the quality of cleaning as well as the safety of the personnel working at site. The solution that we have found out for this is to gradually try and identify right people in the remote areas also. Each zone we have to develop certain number of vendors who can do the module cleaning in a professional way. We only bear the training cost so that maybe 1 year or 2 years down the line, we'll have enough number of O&M solar panel cleaning companies available in remote areas of the country. Third major area is spare parts management. Again, as I discussed earlier, spare parts management is very difficult because of the nature of the business, remoteness of the sites. It is very difficult to challenging to optimize the resource, optimize the spare part cost or the volume. And even I'm not certain where to keep my spares is a major challenge. With proper documentation, we are trying to avoid this with 1 or 2 years operational data. I think we have 40 of our sites which are operating for more than one and a half year now. So we are relatively in a better equipped with the data to decide on how much space are to be kept where. And major area that personally I feel in rooftop solar is the safety. In ground mount solar, because you have the luxury of having at least 4 to 5 people in the site, people always work in tandem, which is called a buddy pair popularly. Buddy pair avoids many of the safety incidents. In case of any accident, you have people to respond immediately. But in case of rooftop solar, because the person is traveling alone and the person is working alone on the solar rooftop, you never know what happens to the person who is visiting the site. So we have introduced a system called on-call buddy pair in coordination with the ROC team. The person who is visiting the site is talking to the ROC, and ROC is in turn connecting with some other person who is available for a call every now and then. And the second person will be calling the first person continuously after every 1 hour to check whether he is safe or not. This is one system that we could introduce, because we cannot, when we talk about 25 sites to a single person, I cannot have the luxury of keeping a second person only because I want safety. And other things are like work permit system we have introduced for our vendors. For our engineers, invariably any activity that they do on any premise, he has to take a work permit from the HOD. That's the system that we have implemented. And we are also on course to implement all the systems that are prevailing in any standard industry in rooftop also, like providing the electrical rubber mats, fire extinguishers, electrical gloves, and all the PPEs to the site engineers who are working on site, including the cleaning labor.
Can I just conclude?
Yes. Finally, this is my favorite quote when it comes to the O&M. The secret of success is to do the common thing uncommonly well. Even if you are doing the same thing for 10,000 times, we have to do it with the same level of quality and consistency. Thank you very much for patient listening.
Thanks, Mr. Ramesh, for your insight of how you manage and the safety aspects, which is definitely a crucial factor in terms of rooftop systems. I will request Mr. Brajesh Kumar from Renew Power to present his.
Responsible for distributed solar O&M for Renew Power. This is all about the myself and Renew. I am going to talk because this forum is not about Renew Power. This forum is about discussing the O&M aspect and issues. So topic mainly I'm going to touch is O&M key challenges and the best practices, common types of module failure, and the remote monitoring. So this is the one question probably I'm going to put in front of everybody. So what do you think? What should be the mindset of a developer? Answer from anybody? What should be the mindset of a developer? You can see the pictures also and correlate. I have put it 2 examples, one for utility solar, one for rooftop solar. So in this slide, what I would like to bring it here, there is a mindset, change in mindset, drastic change in mindset in the developers because of the price war which we all are witnessing these days. And ultimately what is happening, this I personally believe there is a compromise between the one-time cost of the project and the recurring cost. So I mean to say that we are more focused on the one-time project cost rather than the thinking long-term perspective and looking into the recurring cost which are going to be occur if we select the inferior product. So where we should start O&M? In my view, we should start O&M from day one. I mean to say that from point we are thinking to design a project, there has to be input from the O&M, serious input, because we are the guy who is dealing on day-to-day basis with all the products, and we know all the pros and cons, plus and minus of each and every product in detail. So from day one, O&M, in my view, O&M should involve to select a product. Now we can see this example for utility scale. What this picture shows? There are two pictures, and these are projects in the Telangana and the Gujarat. I don't want to quote name here. So utility scale project, one is all works 15 megawatt, another is 10 megawatt. So because of saving one-time cost, we avoided as a developer, and we when I quote we all comes in that. So we try to avoid a one-time land leveling cost, and we executed the project on the lower side of the land. And these two projects of 10 megawatt and 15 megawatt will be flooded for complete monsoon season, at least 3 months, 3 to 4 months, and there will be complete shutdown in the plant. We cannot operate the plant. So just imagine the cost. We saved 1 crore or we lost this 4 months for 25 years. The similar thing in next picture of utility scale, we try to save some of the drainage cost. And now what is costing us, because this plant is on slightly hilly, near hill. So water is, during every monsoon season, water is coming with full force, and it is damaging most of the foundations, the civil structure foundations. And every year you have to repair in a 10 or 12 megawatt plant. Every year you need to repair after monsoon season at least 300 to 400 of foundations. And some of the structures get displaced, caused mechanical stress on the module, and there will be micro cracks in the modules. These are the consequences. Another picture, you can see the rooftop. For rooftop, their selection of a roof is very, very important. We need to see the load bearing capacity of the roof. There is a race here again to do more and more, and roofs are less available, especially if you are doing the projects on the government sectors. Then you will really find, and some of the people can quote this. So some of the buildings are very, very old, and without doing a load bearing test, if you will move ahead, you are putting the complete project on the risk. You don't know whether after 5 years, 7 years, 8 years, what will happen to these roofs. So this is another one of the important thing which I would like to brought it here. There are other challenges. I quickly move on, but one of the main challenges is the which other speakers also spoken about, module warranty. It's a real concern. This is not framed properly. What kind of reporting requirement if we are going to seek for module warranty? In the any of the warranty documents so far I have seen, it is not very clearly mentioned that in case of failure reporting, what kinds of dedicated report is required to get a warranty. What is happening when you report a problem? There will be endless number of document requirement will keep on coming from the OEM, and you fulfill one requirement, they will have another requirement. You will fulfill another, they will have one more requirement. So contract, the buying contract and purchase agreement needs to be defined very clearly, where we need to add the generation loss clause also. In case there are two things, first we need to define which kind of reporting and how many reports is required, really. Sir, just excuse me. Please.
Put it on the full screen.
So, the module contract and purchase agreement should clearly define one is the documentation part, what kind of documentation is required, and second is loss of generation clause also. So, we already discussed whenever module failure is there, there is a logistic, they will take to lab, then they will test it, there is a testing time, then they will send it back to again site, and there is a logistic time. In this course of period, depending on the project size, we are losing lots of generation which is unaccountable and is being bearded by developer only. So there are some specific issues, other issues related to the rooftop basically. So net metering policies are there, but wherever we have these policies, there is a execution issues. So there are no timeline defined that how long it will take to do a net metering, close a net metering at any particular site. So there is no definition for this in any of the policies. Roof access, already one of our panelists has discussed about it. This is an issue in many cases. And roof access from, there are two aspects of it. One is from client side, and another aspect is safety also. Because sometimes to increase capacity on a particular roof, you may design a system and you may put the panels in area where it will be very, very difficult for a maintenance person to reach out. And this is completely unsafe. So if any accident is, I have seen some of the projects where PV modules are projecting outside the boundary of the your roof. So if any modules fell down on somebody, so there are safety aspect also for the maintenance person, as well as the, if you are putting plant in the public area, so that is also a safety concern. Response time for major OEMs, problem is, I've seen in the contracts with the major OEMs like inverter and all, there is no SLA in many cases. If service level agreement is there, then also adherence is not there. So it must be backed up by PVG. But also, in my view, PVG standard as a standard, 5% or 10% we are going to hold. But that is not going to serve our purpose. If as a OEM, I am going to take a risk on the 10% PVG and I will not adhere my SLA, then what I will do? 10% amount is very, very less for your project. So this has to be backed up in properly. Then we will have the weather related issues, which is uncontrollable, that is not in our hand, like rain, fog, etc. Skill manpower availability for the remote location, that is also very, very challenge. Somebody has talked about the training. So you can put up a good technical person for some time in remote locations. But we all know we are not going to retain that person for long time. So kind of training institution we are running if you are putting plant in the remote locations and engineer at remote locations. They will remain there until they get trained and then they will move out. So we need to think why. This is the problem, but we need to think why they are moving out. So whenever we are putting a manpower at remote location, we have to take care of them. There has to be separate, in your HR policies also, there has to be some separate exclusions for those employees which are running at, working at the site. Just believe it, we are expecting from them, we are paying hardly anything, and we are expecting from those engineers to, in case of any breakdown, they can work whole night but we have to take care of them. And they are working. They are sincerely working also. And this is the one main reason, because if they are not get paid accordingly, so we cannot able to retain them for long. So training and retaining, both part is very, very important. Then communication connectivity is one of the key aspect in the rooftop solar.
Mr. Vijayji, yeah. Can you conclude?
Yeah, give me 2 minutes because communication will be part which I am going to discuss. And vandalism at the public places. So that is also one of the challenges. These are the small basic things which we all know and follow, and we have all seen it. So I'll move around. These are the module problems. We already discussed different kind of module problems. But I'm not going to discuss these module problems. Why this is happening? In many cases, down the line, somewhere we have to accept it that it is because of us. During execution also, a mishandling we talked about. So why I have brought this slide here, there is a serious need of testing the plant or doing the due diligence of a plant immediately after the commissioning. There is a serious need of testing the plant, because then only we shall able to compare if I have the EL image from the manufacturer factory, and then if I am doing the EL imaging and the sample testing on the plant which is executed recently, I will able to make out whether this problem occurred, came from the factory, or whether this problem occurred during the execution. And believe me, execution is putting lots of issues on the, especially on the module. Due to mechanical stress, they will overtight, misalignment, these all cause the micro cracks on the module. Need of data monitoring. So bunch of data is coming from the site. 25 million GB data created on daily basis. So getting only data is not the purpose. How to extract the required and desired information from that is the key. I just quickly run through one case study. So our we are monitoring all of our distributed plant remotely from the centralized location from our head office. And there we have even added the feature of getting module killing alert on inverter basis. So I can get an alert if any particular PV array on particular inverter is not killing. Inverter is not killing. So I'm getting the module killing alert from my portal on inverter basis also. I am following, I am getting the alert from breakdown, everybody is getting as a standard RMS protocol. But I am getting a alert from inverter deviation, inverter to inverter deviation. So I am comparing apple to apple. I am not only getting the inverter to inverter deviation alert, I am also getting an alert if 2 MPPT or 3 MPPT of inverter is not behaving same. So I am getting alert if any deviation between the 2 MPPTs of an inverter also. So this is one of the case strategy when we got the alarm, one of the MPPT was not working. Then we further drill down immediately to the our portal. We observed that particular inverter number 5 is not working. We further drill down and went, we found the 1 MPPT voltage is problematic. We further drill down and we come to know that particular MPPT is bad. So same portal we reported to our OEM, and this is the reporting tool, the intervention. Same portal we have reported to our OEM, and there is a provision that once OEM will finish this task, he will have access a browser, he can put the reports and the updates there, and we will come to know case is closed. And we can count each cases with proper remote monitoring. And we have automated all of our reports. Not only the daily reportings, monthly reportings, revenue reportings, as well as the internal review reportings, all these reports are automated. Only in one cases where we need the IQ, there is a human interface that doing the loss analysis. Rest everything is automated for us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your kind intervention. A lot of points you have covered, which are very really required.